In this video, we'll do a quick overview and introduction for Project 3. Project 3 is the fairly simple project involving a switch debouncer. And here is the write-up. Before we go look at the very simple write-up for this project, let's take a look at what is probably the best resource available online on this, what I think is a very interesting topic. And it comes from a website maintained by a fellow named Jack Gansel. I'm assuming I'm pronouncing his name correctly. Here's a picture of Jack, and he has strong opinions on lots of different topics, most of which have to do with embedded systems. So I'm going to look under Special Reports, and you see here debouncing contacts is one of the choices. So this is a very nice report, which he did first in 2004 and has revised at least three times since. And I recommend reading it. Again, if you just go to www.gansel.com and look at the materials that he provides, you'll find this site. Without going into great detail about his background information, I'll introduce this by looking first at this picture, which shows a bunch of switches that he collected and tested. So I think there's about 18 switches here. And he pressed each switch, as it says right here, 300 times, logging the minimum and maximum amount of bouncing for both closing and opening of the contacts, which he describes as mind-numbingly boring, which I agree with, but it's really nice that he did it and we don't have to. So what did he discover? He discovered there was a lot of range in the amount of time that switches spend bouncing, and qualitatively the type of electrical signals produced by the switches also varied quite a bit. This shows a couple of examples here where he was using a mixed signal oscilloscope to be able to look at both the standard kind of oscilloscope voltage traces that we've been looking at in electronic instrumentation, plus also looking at the changes in digital levels that are inherent in monitoring what's going on with digital devices like flip-flops and so forth. And it shows here that switches closing at times may have slowly varying voltages and then jump rather dramatically from what was a 0 to 1, in this case 0 volts to say 5 volts. And or what we normally see as switch debouncing is maybe a lot of intermittent connections with before the final switch from the 0 level to the 1 level is achieved on a regular basis. He's got some very interesting things to say about how the contacts are resistive for a while. I recommend looking at those. But the basic idea is shown here, where what you would really like to see is a high level switch nice and cleanly to a low level and not see a whole bunch of small pulses created. Where you should have a smooth transition from high to low or low to high. The problem is that systems may or may not respond to these short pulses. So you may intend to switch channels on your TV or anything else one channel at a time, and it may jump two channels, it may not do anything. In order to work with a digital system, you really have to have a clean switching event that you can then use as input to control something. I recommend reading through this information and seeing how this sort of situation can be turned into a nice set of clean pulses. And again, as I said, he looks at qualitatively different types of switching. Here it's switching cleanly from 0 to 1 to 0 to 1 when you really only want one switch. And other cases, it switches incredibly quickly and never actually stays at the high level until it reaches this state over here. He looked at a lot of different circumstances, but the general idea was that probably about 20 milliseconds of time is sufficient to handle all of this jiggling that's going on when you, if you're trying to account for one single clean switch event. He then moves on to discuss hardware debouncers. This is using an SR latch, and it's probably one of the best ways of having a nice clean switching event, but this type of switch that switches from one state to another is just not all that common. Normally it's a switch that looks something like this, and consequently this very simple RC debouncer is what he recommends for a hardware solution. This is not the solution that we're going to follow in this course, partly because it's just the route we want to take allows us to more completely investigate the capabilities of the 555 timer. After he looks at hardware and looks at the various models of what's going on in terms of calculating what the parameters should be for the circuits that he's building, he then, again, it says here, there's some various thoughts. Then he moves on to software debouncers. And largely software debouncers, which is an approach used in the embedded systems course here at RPI, known as LIHTC or a variety of other official names, but LIHTC seems to be the one that most people remember. And the idea is to just basically delay a switching event until you're sure all the bouncing has been completed. And there's examples of codes and so forth here, handling multiple inputs. And then he sums up by pointing out there's hundreds of other debouncing algorithms. There's lots of other hardware approaches to doing this too, but I really recommend reading through this to get a very good idea of what switch debouncing is actually all about. Okay, and in this course, we are going to use a 555 timer circuit to debounce a switch. So if you do a search on 555 timer debounce, you'll find a variety of options, most of which will look about the same. And here is the first one that comes up, and consequently it's the one that almost everybody uses. You'll notice it's a standard 555 timer circuit. It's set up as a monostable multivibrator rather than an astable, so it produces a single output pulse rather than a train of pulses. One thing I want to point out to you here is that this capacitor, which is the capacitor that's charged and discharged in order to set the timing of the 555 timer circuit, is indicated as a value in a fairly wide range. Remember, what you have to do is you have to pick this capacitor so that the time constant is significantly longer than any switching event, any bouncing event that might occur. And if you follow what Jack Gansel had to say on his page, you probably want it to be in excess of 20 milliseconds. So you don't just choose the first one, build it, and assume it will work. In fact, if you choose this very small value for capacitance, this device will largely just track the input, and therefore it will produce lots of bouncing in the output. What you want it to do is to produce a long pulse, pay no attention to the bouncing, and give you a clean pulse that you can use for controlling some kind of switching. Okay, now we're back in the write-up for Project 3. The goal here is to design, model, implement, and test a circuit that reliably counts the number of times a push-button switch is pressed by eliminating switch bounce. We do mention a little bit here about the basic ideas, and show some examples of switch bouncing. The report The activities and so forth of this project are meant to be very simple. You just have to state the purpose of the project, describe the process used to demonstrate that the purpose has been achieved, describe the basic theory and analyze the expected performance of your design, describe the simulations you have performed in both PSPICE, MATLAB, or something else if you've decided to use some other tool, describe the experiments you performed, what's your system design, and so forth. Additionally, there is the opportunity for extra credit. The extra credit tasks are described up here. Use the circuit to count events for some simple mechanical system. For example, you can count swings of a pendulum or rotations of a wheel. Please choose something that interests you. Points will be given for simplicity, difficulty, and creativity. So far, I would have to say that the most creative events that were counted were done by a pair of students last year who used an Arduino and an acoustic ultrasonic sensor to measure the motion of their hand. So they basically were just moving their hand toward the sensor and away from the sensor and counting the number of times that the hand moved. So you can count anything. You can count the spokes going by in a wheel. Make it fun. And as I said, the more interesting it is, the more creative it is, the more extra credit points you get. The number of extra credit points given out is not generally large because the creativity hasn't really justified a lot of points. But whenever somebody tries something a little bit different, they always earn a few more points. So that's about it. Have fun with this, and any questions, please send them to me or